humor. And Bart Laper, who was, who John really wanted to come and talk about, I was second to best, but I was three. He calls my name. So Bart Laper would have been a lot better. But, you know, Art, he's kind of a funky economist. And he's only famous because he worked for Ronald Reagan. Probably he's so bold as a state. But he's very famous because he kind of was a small the worst recession we've had since 1938, which occurred in 2018. I talked about my concerns about the economy in late 2008, and CNBC gave me credit for ever more than for forecasting the downturn. I'm not sure I really did it. But that made them think of me as the economist, which I've always been proud of me, of course. So, here with Ronald Reagan's house, I wanted to also talk about some, you know, and pull a little bit from his notes. And Reagan was a great communicator, to say the least. He had a little book of notes that was published long after his passing, I think, but which were handwritten things, quotes from famous people that he thought were highly relevant to the talks that he might be making at the time, or maybe stories he heard in the elevator, not attributed, but he worked those into his talks on a regular basis. And I thought this was a pretty good way to start, about people viewing private enterprise as predatory, tagger to be shot. Others look at it as a cow that can be milked. And certainly Ronald Reagan looked at it as a horse pulling a sturdy wagon. And John goes back to your thoughts. He had great confidence, great optimism in America. He started at the worst of times, a term we hadn't heard in a long time, stagflation. Was prevalent in Reagan's era. Very high unemployment, very high inflation. People really despondent about our economic prospects and the outlook for our children's economic health. You might recall back in the early 80s. And with a little help from Paul Volcker on the inflation front, and a lot of optimism from Reagan, and some sharp tax cuts recommended by Art Laper, really good things began to happen economically in this tenure. So I wanted to just go through quickly kind of the global economy, and I hope that we can come back and have some discussion about this if you have any questions. But I just came from a couple of days, fortunately, in Washington with the Peterson Institute for International Economics, which I've been working with for quite a long time. And so I got to be around, and so I'm taking a lot of the views of their forecast that I've had a chance to discuss with some of the top economic thinkers and policy advisors, not only in the United States, but the world. And I think they have a pretty good view on where we are today. So for openers, the global economy is not as troubled as it was in Reagan's era in many ways, but it's certainly out of sync in a lot of ways. If you kind of look at this as a little bit of economic jargon, but if you looked at real economic growth in the world in sort of the 3 years, 2014, 15, and 16, you can see that growth is kind of slogging along, if you will, on a global basis, a little over 3% annually, which is not good, but it's certainly better than heavy. And it's the global economy coming out of this very horrific recession that we experienced in 2009. The U.S., we're going to come back and talk about that a lot more, but slowly but surely recovering, depending on which television station you might listen to. You wouldn't necessarily think that, but it is. European area, actually there's a little optimism in Europe. As you can see, the growth rate's doubled from a very prolonged recession in Europe and economic lethargy. And we read about Greece and the other problems they're having all the time in the paper. But parts of Europe are doing better, and overall the European economy looks like it's going to do better in the next couple of years than it has been. Japan also recovering. So just think about for a moment, the OECD, the strongest economies of the world, the most developed economies of the world, US, Europe, and Japan, are all growing at pretty slow rates. And of that group, the U.S. is a star. Europe is much worse, Japan's much worse in terms of their economic growth, and that's been true for quite some time. We can talk about a little more about why if you have questions about that. China, which has been certainly headline news because it's gone through their miraculous growth period, they're now the second largest economy in the world, they've been a big engine of economic growth in the world for a long time, is slowing down quite a bit. But slowing down to, let's call it the 5 to 7% growth rate. And that's a big number now, a very large economy. 25 years ago, it was growing at 10-12% per annum, but it was a small economy. Today, it's a large economy, and it's outgrowing most others. In India, another large population country with fairly high GDP and a lot of wealth and smart people, is also accelerating in growth. And they have just elected a new government, this little Reagan S, at least for the Asian year. And their growth is looking much better, suddenly, with changing economic policies in that country. So if we look in a little more detail at the U.S., again, depending on which TV station you're listening to, you wouldn't know this, but unemployment rates are trending down fairly sharply since 2009. It has certainly spiked up very high to about 10%. This is the official rate. And inflation, which we'll come back and talk a little more about, the Federal Reserve is trying very hard to get inflation up to about 2%, not only in the U.S., but around the world. And as you can see, inflation has been stubbornly low. It may go lower in this range, I would guess, this year. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Than the current projections. You can see that shaded area. My economist friends at the Peterson Institute think that's the 70% confidence interval, any forecast is a forecast of what range inflation will be in the coming year. So pretty controlled and very modest, despite the fact that a lot of people have been worried about how much money has been printed in recent years. If you think about the U.S. too, the consumers are going to provide a bit of a boost. This growth in disposable income really comes out largely because oil prices have dropped so dramatically that they have a big pop, positive pop for consumer income. And you can see that if you look at the University of Michigan's consumer sentiment, it's popping back up to higher levels also. So people are starting to feel a little more comfortable about spending, a little more certain. That's probably tied to the unemployment rate coming down, as well as oil prices dropping dramatically. So when you look at the sort of the cross currents, if you will, as to what's affecting our U.S. economy, lower oil prices, big positive. A stronger dollar, meaning more difficult, more challenging to export, a bit of a drag, and much slower foreign growth, which means more difficult to export, a drag. So this kind of shows you on net what these cross currents are doing in terms of how they might impact GDP. And that's how professional economists and forecasters can think about that. Sharply, the lower oil prices, certainly they do have a big positive impact on consumers, put more money in our pockets, and largely that money goes to economists and will be spent in the near-term future. But they also, the counter side of that, they're causing unemployment in a lot of areas because there's a very sharp drop in exploration and production and oil rigs and things like that. And if you read Caterpillar's release today, it's one of their big concerns that demand for equipment going to produce oil and gas is dropping dramatically. In terms of the labor markets, I thought you'd find this chart kind of interesting. This is kind of the blue line is the official unemployment rate in the United States. And as you can see, most economists think that full employment is 4%. It's very hard for it ever to go below 4% just because of people changing jobs and things of that nature. This rate up top, the expanded unemployment rate, reflects people that are in part-time jobs and other jobs that are well below their pay rate maybe. And so they're not fully engaged as they would be in a normal economy. So that's probably another interesting way for economists to look at employment opportunities in the country. Another thing to keep in mind is in terms of participation rates, which people talk about a lot, is in the U.S., the demographics, the baby boom generation is now hitting retirement age. And so the number of retirees every year is climbing rather dramatically. And that has a big impact on participation rates in terms of what percentage of the population is actually working at any point in time. And compensation, because of weakening unions, international competition, and very, very low inflation, you can see labor cost per hour, even with our medical cost, is tracking at right around 2% per annum growth, which has been pretty subdued for quite some time. And even projections out in 2017 keep it down around 3% per annum. So not much inflationary pressure coming from labor cost. Monetary policy in the United States, which has been almost the exclusive tool to get us out of the worst recession since 1938, we've been very aggressive with monetary easing and really pushing the string or pushing the rope, as some economists would describe it, to keep the U.S. economy from going into deflation. And this is really goes back to a lot of economic lessons learned in the 30s with the Great Depression, where when the economy slowed down dramatically, the Federal Reserve system at the time in Congress, they allowed the money supply to actually shrink. And that just aggravated the recession. So those lessons learned, the Chicago monetarists, they're working hard now to ensure deflation doesn't occur. And that's why in a modern economy, for people used to some price inflation, things seem to work a little better with 1.5-2% per annum inflation. So central banks around the world are trying to cause that to happen by pushing more and more money out and trying to stimulate economic growth. That's also being done because the structural side of the economy, the fiscal side, with deficits and things, governments are reluctant to spend. And so in many cases, that's been a drag, is governments have been cutting spending and trying to balance budgets coming out of the recession. So monetary policy has been about the only tool. And maybe just one other point for the bankers in the room. Most people think that the Fed will start tightening around mid-year. Personally, I think they're probably going to do a lot less than they were previously planning. And partly that's because of exchange rates. If you've been reading the paper, the U.S. dollar has surged. In fact, I think the strongest appreciation in any nine-month period since 1973 has just occurred. And most of our major global companies have been really stung by the speed of that appreciation and its impact on their financial results and their ability to export. So you can see that my economist friends who know a lot more about this than I do are basically reducing their expectations of what the Fed's going to do. Most think we'll take a kind of a baby step, see how the markets react, see how the dollar responds in exchange markets, and be pretty cautious about that because they don't want to choke off a recovery that's having trouble getting started. Europeans, just briefly, much more socialistic in their economic policies than the U.S. Much more liberal in terms of paying people not to work, and a euro, which is the same currency for multiple countries that have very different circumstances within their countries and very different fiscal policies, really constrains the economy of the region. So you have unemployment rates in some of the second-tier European countries, particularly Italy, Spain, Greece, that are in the 20%+ range, and then you have much lower levels of unemployment in northern European countries that are much more economically competitive on a global scale. And a lot of stresses and strains on their economic policy because of the single currency euro zone for most of the European area and different fiscal policies across the region. Interestingly enough, in the whole Eurozone, the country that's doing best, even though it's politically not very popular at the moment, is the British government. And their growth rates are up in the 2.5-3% range. So they're doing quite a bit better than continental Europe economically. Greece, I just show you this piece quickly. Greece really is kind of a pimple on the global economy, I would say. It really doesn't matter that much. It's good headline news. And their debt levels are more than double most of the year. That's about, they have about 200% debt to GDP ratio. So they're in a big hole. They could get bailed out by the northern European countries. They probably will be eventually because nobody wants to risk breaking up the euro because of the more geopolitical concerns than economic concerns. And Greece is the size of a small city in China. So, it's important, but not that important. In terms of long-term interest rates, you know, look at the scale. This is 3% is the high on that line. These are 10-year bond rates. And it's not, you know, just the U.S. rates are low. In fact, ours aren't nearly as low as German and Japanese rates. I mean, you almost have to pay the bank to let you own the bond and or pay the bondholder. So it's, in fact, there are some negative interest rates in New York these days. The bankers would like to keep your money. So this is kind of an unhealthy situation, and there's not much more room for monetary policy to work. That's why structural reform is very important. And as we look at that sort of magic 2% that central banks around the world seem to be thinking about, trying to inflation up to around that level to try to regen their overall economies. The U.S. has got, you know, the closest to the line, if you will. Japan has had a long period of deflation, which has been very problematic for that economy, and Europe's down. Now, there's kind of one interesting thing, and in my view, for the next 20 years or so, for the foreseeable future, if you will, Europe and Japan are going to have very, very unique growth rates. And basically, it comes back to the economic terms of population. They don't have enough productivity to grow. Actually, they have populations that are shrinking in most cases. So that's problematic for them. The U.S., on the other hand, mainly because of immigration and a little higher birth rates than the Europeans and Japanese have, we have some positive growth in population. And the developing world, of course, has much more. That's very important there. So, as you can see, the slap in Japan is pretty close to full employment, and they tend to maintain that through thick and thin. That's very difficult to lay people off. The population in Japan is aging. Right now, there are so many people retiring in Japan, the baby boom generation, and so few births of the people entering the workforce, that with very slow economic growth, they still maintain close to full employment. In the U.S., you know, if you were on Fox News, you'd probably be surprised to see that our unemployment rate has come down as significantly and steadily as it has, but it is trending down. If you, as I mentioned, exchange rates, we're very much a global economy. Most of our large firms compete everywhere. And if you look back to early, mid-2014 to today, you can see the trade weighted U.S. dollar has increased more than 20% in that period of time. If you're a manufacturing company, usually you're working in the margins of in the sort of 5-7% range. You can imagine what kind of trauma that is. As you try to manage your facilities around the world and stay profitable and, you know, not have to turn the apple cart upside down. Huge, huge challenge that many companies are facing. And if you're in the wrong places, I mean, if you're just in the U.S. and you're just an exporter, it's doubly difficult because to stay competitive, you have local competitors, you have to dramatically reduce your prices, and that's probably won't work. Most large multinationals are produced in regions in which they sell, so their cost and prices kind of stay in the same currency and they can protect their margins. Although even in those cases, for a U.S. large multinational, ultimately you're reporting in dollars, so if you make the same margins in Europe or Japan, and when you bring those dollars back to the United States, it translates into a lot fewer dollars. And if you've been watching financial reports from big companies, they're all really being stunned by this at the moment. And interestingly enough, since Milton Friedman, who was my sort of academic godfather of the economist of all economists, you know, he kind of got us, helped us get from the Brent Woods fixed exchange rate world over to flexible exchange rates. Most of us thought that would be a good solution. But I don't think we realized that they would, in the real world terms, as people are looking out and continents and countries comes and goes and regions comes and goes, we get these dramatic swings over very short periods of time. It's not just differential rates and inflation that cause these movements, but it's really confidence in the economic performance of different governments and countries over time. And sometimes it's swing, as in this case, more than 20% on the weighted average basis in a 9-month period of time. Pretty challenging. I want to talk a little bit about China because it's been headlined. This is a country that I've spent a lot of time in and thinking about and watching. And quite frankly, it's the most miraculous thing that's happened in probably the history of economic time for the Chinese economy to have grown as rapidly as it did. When I first moved there in 1983, virtually the mountain had been very successful. We created a very egalitarian society, and almost everyone there had about the same income, which was not very much. They were all poor. They all wore blue gray mouse suits. Most rode bicycles. There were no world class hotels. There were very few flights to most cities and old Russian planes. It was no infrastructure to speak of. In 25 years, it's absolutely gone crazy in terms of growth. It just goes back to 78 when a lot of companies were beginning to enter China and invest there. And as you can see, the growth rate probably averaged close to 10% for the better part of 20 years, which is staggering economic performance. And they've gone from no infrastructure to an infrastructure that arguably might be better than ours now in terms of roads, railroads, ports, power grid, you name it. It is truly impressive, and the wealth has dramatically changed. During my little discussions at the Peterson Institute, not just China, but the emerging markets of the world now, interesting enough, have 42% of the world's billionaires live in emerging market countries. The world's changed a lot, and China's changed profoundly. A property investment has been, as you can just see from this chart, it's been going a little crazy of late. In the 09 recession, they were impacted. They went through the floor. Interestingly enough, China helped stabilize the world a lot because when the floor fell out in 2009 of their property market and of their exports, the Chinese government, wiser I would say than many governments, threw a lot of money into infrastructure investment. They took their five-year plan and they said, well, we need to get all these things done. We've got all this unemployment, we've got a property market collapse, and they dumped money into the accelerated building of airports, roads, railroads, ports, power grid, all those things that they can control and they dumped money into. And it kept their economy growing at a better rate than the world economy, despite a dramatic drop in exports. And as you can see, as they moved out, more problems happened. So this property market has not only the dip in 09, it resurged briefly and has dipped again. If you look at just the prices, and we used to think housing prices went up everywhere all the time, even Americans saw that. It turns out that they don't, and even now in China, with a lot of excess property in the market, prices are falling. Still relatively expensive, but declining. And here's another interesting thing. It turns out the communists aren't all omnipotent to think about their economy. They radically overinvested in a lot of things. One of them, steel, for example, they went from virtually a really poorly structured, weak steel industry back in the 80s, let's say. And by 2010, they had more steel capacity than the rest of the world added up. rest of the world added up, they had more steel capacity. So they overshot dramatically. And as you can see, production of, this would be true for a lot of their base material industrial capacity, and in some cases for coal production in the country. And all of these things now have come down very sharply. There was a period ending in 2010, I think Dick Vincent would know this better than mine himself, but of raw commodities, the metals, for copper, for iron ore, and zinc, most major metal commodities, the Chinese took 70% or more of the world production, which is part of the reason we have this big commodity bubble. And when it popped, it's sort of ugly. Another interesting thing about China is the Chinese are very, they're uncertain about their retirement age and what the governments have programs for. And unlike Americans, we spend most of what we get. The Chinese are huge savers. And one of the things the Chinese government now recognizes it must do because of the economic imbalances in the world economy is they've got to get Chinese households spending more domestically. They even need to import more because the trade balances are out of line. So this has been sort of a big positive story in China. They have been successfully getting the Chinese consumers to spend more. Chinese economic well-being is growing dramatically. And they need to accelerate that even further. So they are a more balanced player in the global economy. That's kind of why I said it's sort of good news, bad news, good news, I think. They are doing a very good job of transitioning their economy. And quite frankly, I'm very optimistic that they are going to be one of the leading global economic players for the next couple of decades. Their credit growth, the Chinese central bank is trying to wind theirs down. It's much higher than most places. And there's a lot of squealing from particularly the property sector that they're doing it too fast. But as you'll see from my economist friends, and probably the Pearson Institute has their economic staff on China, is, I would say, the best in the world. They're really looking at that economy. They're there frequently. They work with Chinese think tanks. They've got better data. But it's going through a very necessary rebalancing. It's going to be a lot less investment in the next 20 years or 10 years, certainly, in industrial capacity. Less of infrastructure. They're going to really work hard to put in a social network, safety net, if you will, to allow Chinese citizens to feel more comfortable about spending their money because they want to drive demand within the country. Of course, they'd like to supply all of that from within China, so they're going to boost more consumer goods and import more because they need that global balance. Biggest risk, certainly, there could be a collapse in their property market that would be much more difficult to handle, or their central bank could succumb to a lot of political pressures to help that property market by just pumping out more credit. But overall, I think the consensus, certainly among economists that are really focused on it, is it's likely to transition pretty well. So overall, this global economy is out of sync. The U.S. is doing better than the OECD, other OECD countries. Many emerging market countries are struggling, but China and India, the two big kahunas in terms of size and weight in the global economy, do pretty well. We're beginning to think about now coming off of monetary easing that we've been doing for the last 3 years very aggressively. At the same time, the Europeans and the Japanese are pushing monetary ease. So that's creating a lot of stress, and you see that show up in exchange rate markets. The U.S. should benefit as long as the Fed responds by being very cautious about how fast we come off monetary ease and how quickly we tighten. But likely, persistently low inflation, low interest rates for quite a while, and because monetary policy has little scope to do more, that creates a certain vulnerability in and of itself. So now I'm going to get to part of what we're going to talk about. And that's just with this economic primer of what's going on in the world right now. Think about the world a little bit from where do we go from here? And the U.S., and how do we do a better job of positioning ourselves to compete in the global economy? Because I'm very convinced that how competitive we are in the world economy is going to have a lot to do with the welfare of our children, grandchildren, in my case. It's going to have a lot to do with the United States' influence and international relations in the world, whether we can afford to be a leader or not. And it'll be a very different world if we're not. So if you think about sort of the post-World War II period, I would submit that the world usually works better when there's a twin engine running the global economy's plane. If you think about right after World War II, we were kind of the tallest dog standing in the global economy. We were a beacon of strength. We won. We had economic strength. Europe was decimated. The emerging markets weren't there yet. So after the 50s and our Marshall Plans and other things, and Germany's getting their economy back together, we had twin engines for a while. We had the U.S. and Germany both driving, and with a lot of economic cooperation between those, good economic growth, Europe was recovering. As that faded away, Japan came on the scene. And you might recall that Japan was going to own almost all of America there for a while. And they were doing extraordinarily well. Everybody went to Japan to learn how to manufacture again. Much to the chagrin of some people. But the 70s and 80s, the US and Japan were kind of the twin engines of our global economy. As Japan faded, the BRICS, Brazil, India, China, Russia, came on stage and wrote a lot about them, and those high population emerging market countries were, you know, really getting traction, growing, becoming global players, people investing in them, and they were investing in their own growth. So they drove a lot of economic growth, probably for about 15 years, in the 90s, right out to 2005 or so. Then the BRICS began to fade away, and China stayed strong, but the others faded. And it was the U.S.-China that drove the global economy for a while. As China got critical mass, if you will. And what I'd like to argue now, and it's really important to me, and I think to the economists I was just hanging out with in Washington, who's, I think, some of the smartest thinkers about the U.S. economy and the world economy, and where we go, it's likely going to be the U.S. and the Pacific Rim. I think we've been transfixed on U.S. Europe for a long time, come from European heritages in many cases, but the European economy is kind of a still in the water and likely not going to change much in the next 20 years or so. It will never long. But the Pacific is critically important, which brings us back to trade. And one of the things that probably I spent a lot of my time as both an economist early and then as a business leader thinking about international trade and how the U.S. positions itself to compete in world markets and how important trade is. Case, and I couldn't say this again because I've repeated it too many times, but we Americans, and there's not a Rotary Club in America quite to do this, but we represent only 5% of the world's population. We wouldn't have any great companies if they weren't globally competitive. And so we need to keep that in mind. And we can't build a big wall around a place and succeed. We've got to force ourselves to compete. And that means being out there and engaged. So just a quick primer on international trade, and if you've been reading the New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, certainly, it's top of the news right now. And the economic conference that I was just now a couple of days at with my friends at Peterson, they're gritting their teeth and knowing that the U.S. could either dramatically step up its game in terms of global leadership on trade, or drop out of the game, and like 2 decades are going to be lost. And these guys have put a huge amount of work into it, so they're very worried about it. But key things to think about. First, Proverbs law about fast track trade promotion authority. This is what gives the president and the administration and the executive branch of the government the opportunity to negotiate a trade agreement with other foreign countries and then send it to the Congress for an up or down vote. I mean, Congress will get to decide, do we accept it or not, but they don't get to modify the trade agreement. And you can imagine, if you were a foreign government, that you would be pretty unwilling to negotiate with the U.S. government if you thought after you got through working out the whole deal, these are very complex, you had to send it to the Congress with 435 people, make little suggestions of how you can change it again. Just wouldn't work. It's not going to work. So we either get trade promotion authority and give that to our president and executive branch to finalize the negotiation or done that. We've been negotiating the Trans-Pacific Agreement now for the last 4 years. The president didn't ask for trade promotion authority until the State of the Union addressed this year. So it's basically his first 7 years in office, he didn't have it. The Democratic Party has been pretty vehemently opposed to giving that to the administration, primarily because labor unions vehemently opposed to almost any trade. They like us to build a wall. NAFTA, I want to talk about in just a second, because this is probably one of my biggest irritations. We all need to know that. That the North American Free Trade Agreement, which we signed in 1993, that you recall NAFTA as the North American Free Trade Agreement, created a free trade zone, if you will, or a duty-free zone between Mexico, Canada, and the United States. It dramatically improved economic development. It's certainly been vilified in the press and by politicians running. I mean, everybody that lost a job in the country for the 20 years following that, they got blamed on the NAFTA agreement. And it got very little credit for what good things happened. But the reality is, it was highly successful. Almost every economic study I've ever seen anywhere suggests that growth accelerated in the U.S., Canada, and of course most in Mexico. Trade grew from less than $300 million a year to $1.1 trillion over that 20 years. That's a 500% increase about. We export the United States five times more to Canada and Mexico than we do to China. Over double what we do to the European Union as a whole. So North America is our bastion of strength. Mexico, which was the poorest by far of the three countries that entered NAFTA, has had growth rates more than double ours over that period of time. The Mexican middle class has grown dramatically. Exports to Mexico, as I noted, are up dramatically. Interestingly enough, immigration has slowed to a trickle. A lot of the Mexican Americans came here or going back home. And think how many Mexicans would have been trying to walk across the border if we'd built a wall and tried to keep them out and not traded with them. That would have been a huge tragedy. And what really galls me is people, almost everybody I know, Republican or Democrat, and I was actually on a commission a couple of years ago put together by the Council on Foreign Relations about our country has lost its appetite for trade. And that commission included Senator Daschle, who I mentioned in the White House, because he was a Democrat and vehemently anti-trade. It included a couple of labor leaders, including some business people like myself. And I thought, when we started this commission, we'll never agree on anything. And about 8 months later, we put together a very comprehensive writing on all the benefits that trade is doing for this country. I've never seen an economic study that said that was bad, and yet I don't know if the press is just lazy or it's too easy to cite simple examples of where trade has damaged someone, but they never did their homework. They would never talk about the tremendous benefit that this continent, North America, has derived from that. So, that's part of the reason the public is so anti-trade, and at best, they're ambivalent. So fast forward to the Trans-Pacific Partnership. This is an agreement with 11 countries, including U.S., Canada, and Mexico, so all of North America, Chile and other countries that we already have free trade agreements with in South America are part of this coalition. It includes Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, a number of countries in the Pacific region, but 40% of the world's population. It's a very comprehensive trade agreement that really levels the playing field for U.S. firms to compete and export to those countries. It opens up a lot of ag export opportunities. It helps us set the stage. People that I've worked with closely, Council on Foreign Relations, view this as critically important. It's kind of part of our Asian strategy to at least contain the Chinese, who are investing aggressively across all of Asia, and they would like to follow this. This kind of positions the U.S. to make a lot of the trade and economic relationships related rules if we pass this legislation. And also it gives us an opportunity to eventually bring China, India, and Indonesia, sort of the big three outliers at the moment from TPP, into this trade agreement, which would be a real boon for macroeconomic growth without a lot of government investment. Exactly the kind of thing I'll lay in the glove, I'm sure, if we need to be here. So, my economist friends have been working on this, and for them, this is, I don't think they can imagine the worst Greek tragedy. And now we have a string of ethicals working together. President Obama's proposed trade promotion party, TPA, back in the State of the Union address. His USTR, Owens is very, very keen on getting it. And they have to work with, the only way to pass is they get almost unanimous Republican support in the Congress, because it's going to get very few Democratic votes. So it's a very contentious party line debate, and the business community will have to work very hard with the Republicans to help them all stay the course. There's a few defections, and it will pass. And if the And that's the TPA part, because if the president doesn't have trade promotion authority, then TPP won't have, because nobody's going to negotiate to the end of this deal. So it's kind of a two-pronged thing. I was pretty pleased. I mean, the Washington Post and the New York Times don't often write positive editorials about trade, but they have in the last week both. President Obama was quoted as saying, "Some music to my ears, that the AFL-CIO will never find a trade agreement that they would embrace, and will never be for TPA." So he wasn't surprised that they were vigorously proposed. But of course, that leaves him without his own party to get legislation passed that he needs to see this through to conclusion, and we're very, very close. Very important for me. The Western part of the United States, because it'll open up a lot of ag doors, particularly agricultural exports, to countries like Japan, who've been very resistant. So it's a big breakthrough. And TPA, TPP, keep those in mind. If TPP happens, then the transatlantic trade agreement will almost certainly follow behind it, because the Europeans won't want to get behind it. But you know, these things are little stepping blocks. If the first one doesn't happen, trade promotion authority, fast track legislation, then everything's off. And my good buddies in Washington feel like we will have lost a decade of opportunity, or maybe several decades of opportunity. That happens. I love that. These little quotes from Reagan's book I thought were pretty good. The nation expects to be ignorant and free in a state of civilization. What never was and what never will be. And we're in the midst of a public, and I say to the public, because I expect more of our politicians. I would expect our politicians to lead and to understand and to help the public understand so that we get the right kind of policies in place. And I don't see that happening. Another little Reagan quote, that ignorance is bliss. Now she doesn't think it is. People be jumping up and down in joy. So switching over to another one of Reagan's favorite subjects, taxpayers. I thought this was a pretty good quote. Someone who doesn't have to pass a civil service exam to work for government. And many of us can relate to that line. And of course, Reagan's bipartisan. He found quotes, and he wrote them down so he could talk to the other party. Kennedy on tax cuts, our true choice is not between tax cuts on the one hand, avoidance of large federal deficits on the other. Our economy is stifled by restricted tax rates. We'll never produce enough revenue to balance the budget. Justice, it will never produce enough jobs and profits. Who remembers what the marginal tax rate was at the top when Reagan took office?
70%.
70%. I had a lot of good Reaganites in here. And he took it, the top rate, to 28. Now, we did run some very large deficits after that. And he does, you know, he gets credit for the tax cuts and the economic stimulus, but he also gets a little tar from the deficits and credits. So I want to just talk for a minute about this would be my view as a citizen who spent a lot of time both as an economist and being interested in economics and hanging around with some good economists. I wouldn't say I was one, but I hung around with good ones. And thinking about public policy and how the U.S. competes and looking at how other nations compete. And it's not that difficult. I think these things are very important because I certainly, you know, I have enough to take you to eat and drink on here on out, I think. But I'm very concerned for our country and for our children's children and their standard of living and whether this country stays a leading beacon in the world economy. But one of the things we've got to do is honestly address our chronic deficit problems. And I would say that they are not really as hard as we politically always, you know, make them seem. The biggest problem certainly is we have an aging population. We have a demographic bubble with the baby boom generation all retiring, and then we consume a tremendous amount of Social Security monies, and that fund's going to run out at a certain point. And that's a pretty solvable problem. I'm going to be years out a little and make some means testing so that people who don't need it don't get it. It's a hard thing to say, but that would solve the math of the Social Security problem. The biggest problem more is Medicare, and again, the aging population, and the fact that health care costs in this country are about double the average per capita cost of the next highest OECD country. Now, they're you know, 18-20% of GDP is growing, and that's going to stifle our economy within their grip around that. So, there's a lot of smart people who've got to figure this out, but something's wrong when we're spending twice as much per capita for no better outcome than most of the other OECD countries in the world. If we can solve that problem, then we really solve the deficit problem. But think about the vested interest on all sides of that equation and how to have an intelligent conversation about it with the public at large. It's a thorny knot that a lot of good people have got to get to work on to fix. Reforming the tax code, we know in this country we undersave as a population, and we need more investment because that's what creates a productivity growth and a higher standard of living. So what we have to do in our tax code is savings and investment. One of the big things we need to do is change our corporate tax code to a territorial tax system. We tax our multinational companies on a universal tax. So whatever profits you make in the world, our government says you owe us 35% in round numbers. And so if you make a profit in China, let's say, and the Chinese tax rate is 20%, if you bring the money back to the United States, you pay another 15 on top of that. If you leave the money in China and reinvest it in China, or you do R&D in China or some other things and never bring it back, then you don't never pay that extra 15%. So guess what? It is a huge incentive for U.S. multinational companies to leave money offshore, not repatriate it back to our country. We're the only major country today that has a universal tax system as opposed to a territorial tax system. It's highly detrimental to U.S. economic interest, and we need to change that. It's a tough conversation to have with the public, smart legislatures, and people that really study it, all to understand it, and it's a no-brainer. The other thing is that we're not getting the money. There's a couple of trillion dollars on U.S. multinational corporation books that's sitting offshore, not coming home because of the differential tax. And they're paid to take care of shareholders. So they're incentive to reinvest outside the country, to buy companies outside of the country, to move some R&D offshore, consume money, and get the same work done. And that's a big problem. We need to think about incenting. We have an R&D tax credit. So if you remember, this was your days in the R&D tax center. And about every 2 years, it runs out. And all the legislatures put their hand out and give a donation to corporations so they'll be reinstated. But it's not something corporations can count on. And we need to be competing to have more and more research and engineering done in this country and not let it go abroad. So that's an important tax incentive that should be permanent, as well as we should be incenting companies to invest capital in this country to create jobs, good jobs. We should also be welcoming and aggressively pursuing foreign direct investment. And with a lot of our concerns about security, we started pushing foreign direct investment away in some cases. And keep in mind that most emerging markets like China are open-armed, you know, to American companies to come and bring your R&D dollars, come and bring your investments. We'll allow you to acquire companies and compete in our economy because it raises their standard with them. And we have been slow to that table, and we can do a lot better. Making our personal tax system both fairer and a lot more transparent. I think a lot of Americans are losing faith in our system. They think they're not getting paid, you know, others are not paying their fair share. So we need to really think hard about a fairer system, a flatter tax rate, and a lot of transparency there. And we've got to wean ourselves from all the loopholes that we, in many cases, a large number of Americans love. Mortgage interest tax deduction, things of that nature. I mean, lower, simpler marginal tax rates would go a long ways to fix many things. Invest in infrastructure. In our case, we went through this atrocious recession and we worked hard to reduce our deficits in the wake of the 09 deficit that occurred with incomes fell dramatically. And instead of borrowing and investing, we did a lot of transfer programs that didn't help the economy for the long term. What we didn't do is invest in roads and bridges that need fixing, in better airports that would open things up, and better port infrastructure, better rail capabilities. All of these infrastructure things that have a huge impact on global competitiveness of an economy. And one of my worries now is that, you know, China's getting really good at this. I mean, they've got spectacular airports, logistics parks with rail systems hooking up the country to big ports. They're very efficient at moving things from factory to port for export, getting things in and out. Their power grid has gotten dramatically better. And they have just radically changed the game. And many emerging markets have probably been falling behind. We need to develop a very thoughtful immigration policy. Again, we're political loggerheads about it. It's so emotional we can hardly have a good conversation about it. Even some of the parties that I liked last time suggested we do things like tell 12 million Mexican American families to go home and let them self-deport themselves, which would have been economically crippling to our own country. Because in many cases, if we didn't have static labor, we wouldn't have any labor. And on the intellectual side, our high-tech companies can't get enough PhDs that can get visas to stay in this country. And our universities are losing a lot of people because they can't get visas that they can be sure they can stay there long enough to finish their degrees. So you've got a lot of our best universities establishing campuses in Shanghai and Singapore. And that's not a recipe or a trend that's going to help our country sustain its rates. We've been a country of immigrants forever. And most of us came here with immigrant parents, and we're losing our edge. So that needs, certainly needs attention. Our educational system, which we're all proud of, for many decades, we have the best education system in the world. Now, if you look now at comparative statistics across the OECD countries, our K-12 group lags behind most other countries. If we're 17th or 18th on the scale. And that's not a good standard. So, you know, we still, I think, have the best universities in the world. Kids from all over the world still want to come here, but we're working hard to dial that back, and I see a lot of that being around large land-grant schools, where, you know, in the science and math, STEM disciplines, particularly at the doctorate level, the majority of the students, you know, are coming from outside of the country. And the best and brightest are, you know, do want to come here. And it's always been in our economic interest to welcome them, and many of them stay. And those are people that create, bring a lot of innovation, a lot of ideas, create a lot of jobs. And if we dissuade them from coming here, then they will create a lot of innovation and a lot of new companies and create a lot of jobs in other countries that we'll have to compete with. The other thing is, really, since the Kennedy administration before, we have kind of led global trade organization. We then regularly confident in our ability to compete. And we championed the free and open markets. We just wanted a fair opportunity to compete. So we need to get back to get our mojo back, get back out in front and lead and create opportunities, open doors for U.S. companies. And not incentivize us to move investments offshore. That's a pretty, six little ideas. I submit to you that it would really make a difference if we would we'd go with those. And so I'm getting older, so I thought this was a pretty good quote to end on. Dread getting old because there are a lot of things we won't be able to do anymore. Don't worry, you won't want to do them. So, with that, happy to call. Let me pause and did I say anything that provoke you or cause you despair? I hope not. Because I'm here that I am optimistic. I'm optimistic about the U.S.'s ability to be. And eventually, I'm optimistic about the public's will to engage. And I would just need some political leadership in both parts to help us figure out how to do that in the very best way. So, with that, yes.
Well, you had a lot of very thoughtful suggestions. And excuse me if I missed it, but is there anything you think the United States is doing right?
Well, we are the strongest growing economy in the industrialized world. We still have the absolute highest standard of living, but just others are gaining on us quickly. And I would say we are still far and away the most entrepreneurial. We have positive people, maybe coming from all over the world, and an openness and an engaging creativity in a number of pockets around in our country that are truly world-leading. And we just need to nurture those things. I was just sharing my words with you. It's your life.
Hey, over here. Sorry,
okay.
The TPP is a trade liberalization program between Pacific and the United States and North America in general. Could it be as ineffective as the European Union was? Because besides the European Union could have made that trade liberalization ineffective in Europe, could that same thing possibly happen to the TPP? And is that size what made NAFTA so successful that it was such a small size of countries working together instead of 12 or 30?
Well, I would argue that the European Union has been radically less successful than it could have been. And, well, I'm going to get Vincent and I were both in Europe at the time, and they had multiple currencies, D-marks and Calibera, Spanish Pesadas and everything else that were all fluctuating and made by challenges. But they formed a union that was a free trade zone. It was very helpful for a while, but because they went to a single currency, the euro, and except for the British, which stayed out, but they basically formed a free trade zone, and they allowed each of the countries to maintain its own fiscal policy. So therefore, you had countries like Greece, Spain, Italy, with unemployment rates somewhere between 15% and 40%, and a lot of economic stress in those countries that can't be relieved by currency adjustments. And you have a lot of very liberal labor rules that cause very high unemployment to be paid and relatively large deficits to be run. And so real economic growth in the European theater just kind of ground to a halt almost. You know, it's been virtually zero for almost 5 years, and now we're excited because it's moving up to about 1.5%, 1.5%, which most people think is kind of a sustainable level. So I think the European experiment is not working nearly as well as it could. North American agreement, free trade agreement either worked much better. Everybody kept their own currency. Everybody kept their own fiscal policy. We eliminated almost all the tariffs. We created much more free flow of goods between the countries. A lot of investment moved to Mexico. A lot more jobs were created in Mexico. Mexico went from basically a poor farming area to a more industrialized area. U.S. started exporting a lot more to Mexico as their standards of living went up. So we benefited also, as did Canada. So this North American experiment was much better. The Trans-Pacific Agreement is taking the three countries in North America, along with Chile and Peru and Japan and Australia, New Zealand, countries, Singapore, that we almost have free trade type arrangements with anyway, or very low tariffs. It's further reducing tariffs, and it's opening up a lot of protected markets like agriculture in particular, that, and it's helping the U.S. with these other, I think, sophisticated, relatively developed economies create better rules for trading. The WTO, which I didn't put on my current chart, which is the World Trade Organization based in Switzerland, has become nearly dysfunctional because, you know, if you read the papers 7 or 8 years ago, things like the multilateral global trade agreements just kind of always collapsed because a handful of countries, in fact, only a relatively few of 140 or so members, could stop the negotiations. So this is an attempt to find 11 like-minded countries, TPP, with 40% of the world's population that can agree on most all the rules of the road, and then they'll try to onboard. You told me yesterday, Indonesia, which is a country I like a lot, and India are both expressing interest to join. So they would come in separately, but then they'd have to play by the same rules. So it began to position us to open up a much broader market for many American firms and agricultural exports, and help us kind of shape the commercial world, I guess, that we've been competing. So I'm pretty excited about the TPP. And I think we have led that back in those. We've led it this far, but now we have the political consensus to take it over the hump. And that's going to require us to have trust in giving the president the ability to negotiate at least something we can vote either up or down. Otherwise, we can't have.
During all the time that the U.S. has been doing trade negotiations, say the last, since 93, say, have the federal government, any of the state governments, have they done anything to improve the competitiveness of the U.S. worker?
Well, I think that we've done a lot. I mean, our colleges in this university, in the country, four-year colleges and our community colleges in many states have put in a tremendous number of training programs to help train the local workforce for different employers, both U.S. investors as well as foreign companies that are investing in our country.
I'm speaking in terms of the tax code and regulations.
The R&D tax credit, which is, an on-again, off-again thing, because it generates a lot of political contributions. They have kept it in place largely over the last 20 years.
But we still have corporate tax rates that are...
That are way out of line with the national, international norms, yes. And maybe 30 years ago, we had such disproportionate strength that didn't much matter. But I'd say we don't have that strength anymore. I've tried to use the example. Take the General Motors investment in China. They want to make cars there. It's a U.S. multinational company. If the tax rate is 20% for the Korean companies, the Japanese companies, the European companies, and the Chinese domestic players, and GM's got to pay 35%, they're not that much smarter, I can assure you. That 15% delta will kill them. And is it in American interest to have GM be successful there? I think yes. I'd like to have some of the leading companies over here.
Can I make one more comment? Would it be better if we just set the corporate tax rate to zero for manufacturers? Wouldn't the country be a lot better off?
You'd have to change it. You'd have to go to kind of a value-added tax, consumption-oriented tax, and I don't think we have a political appetite to do that, but yeah, I might have to warm up to that idea. I mean, I think we could make a more efficient tax system that would drive, again, I come back to savings and investment. Driving savings and investment in the country is what's going to create real economic growth, which is, in the end, going to be very beneficial to our citizens. So, yeah, that's a radical turning upside down of the tax code and starting with a clean sheet of paper. And a lot of economists would like to do that. Even when Reagan cut the taxes from 70 to 28%, the marginal tax rates, and he did get rid of a lot of loopholes temporarily. And within 5 or 6 years, he put most of them back in place. And it wasn't just politicians, it was citizens that wanted their loophole back in, including businesses. So, it takes a lot of discipline, I think, from the political class to say, we're going to streamline and simplify and make it efficient. And then they have to do a lot of education to pull that off and to sustain it. Doesn't happen. It happens in rural places like Switzerland or something, but not in a sophisticated, complex societies like we have.
First of all, thank you for coming to the town to speak to us. And my question is, I know you touched on this briefly earlier in your presentation. Could you go a little bit more in depth on your thoughts that the effect of strengthening the American dollar will have on the economy of the United States and international trade?
Well, I mean, quite frankly, I think it's always a good sign when your currency is strong. It suggests you do good things. You have better technology, and you're outgrowing the competition, and your economy is stronger, and you have very low inflation relative to others, your currency should strengthen. The challenge is, it goes in kind of almost emotional waves here. When the U.S. introduced monetary easing in the very beginning, the dollar got depreciated a little bit. Our manufacturing got a little more competitive. And then as we kind of got back on track growth-wise, and other countries started easing, then the dollar swung and dramatically increased in value in a very short period of time. So I think that kind of volatility in the world markets undermines confidence. It undermines business confidence and making investment decisions. And it has a big impact immediately on your financial results. I'm going to have a news board that's been complaining about it a lot or been expressing concerns about it a lot because they sell all over the world, 75% or more outside of the United States, you know, all of a sudden, almost all those revenues were 20% less than they were a very short time ago. So it's, you know, for a big company like Caterpillar, you know, our return on sales is, you know, 7% or so, to have the currency swing 27% inside of 9 months is almost impossible to deal with. And so you kind of get whipsawed around. It takes 5 or 6 years to build a large plant and make it fully productive. And you can't move it that quickly. You're kind of naturally hesitant to say, you've got to work, because you've worked to be that way. But still, we have a lot of products that are built in single currency zones that we export around the world. And it creates a lot of transformation. So I think the volatility is the big concerning factor. I don't have an easy way to fix that. And in fact, just listening to the economists debate whether we should be interceding with our central bank to try to regulate currency markets. You know, the pros and cons and the arguments on that are it's almost like a cartoon. I wasn't sure which side of the bullion if you voted both sides. And I think it's impossible. And, you know, so we are allowing free markets to work, but sometimes the stock markets and exchange markets can be they move very quickly, and we just have to manage through. We don't have a good solution.
Thank you.
But it's a period of instability that will undermine confidence for sure. Yeah.
I have a couple of questions on this after the president. If I remember correctly, the last tax holiday that we had, it wasn't very successful. And there were only a few sectors in the economy, like pharmaceuticals, maybe the IT firms, who actually brought a lot of money back into the country. Do you know more about that? Do you know why it wasn't so successful in terms of seeing more money being brought home?
Yeah, I think what they did is they said you can bring it back for a very modest tax on it, and it was a short window of time to bring it back. I think most bubble companies are, you know, they've kind of begun to think through the process of, I'm earning these profits offshore, a lot of my customers are offshore, I've got investments to make, maybe acquisitions and or R&D, and it's, they just didn't bring it back for that reason. The Germans, for example, and the Japanese in recent years have both come to a territorial tax system, and they both set a very small tax, and they bring the money back from 2-3%. Fairly de minimis, and I think it sort of cleared things out, isn't it? Our Congress likes to do things. We'll give you, you know, if you bring it back in the next quarter, we're going to let you do it for free. It just doesn't seem right. It doesn't work very well, in my opinion. I've always encouraged, don't do a temporary holiday. It's just disruptive. Give it, you know, think through carefully, set the rules, and let's go with it. You know, and I think eventually we'll change it, I think. And most companies are going to hold out until we do. Yeah, another question.
The second question, that's the last one. when we talk about open trade, we know that wealth is going to improve. That's something that we have seen from the slides. What do you think about employment and job creation? Do you think that most of the fear about open trade comes from the idea that the number of jobs moving abroad are going to be bigger than the number of jobs being created?
Yeah.
Because the wealth is definitely going to go up.
Well, I think there's always winners and losers in trade agreements. And certainly, yeah, I would be the first to say, there were some factories that closed in the United States because of NAFTA and jobs moved to Mexico. But if you looked at, you know, there were jobs lost when we went from, you know, riding around horses, riding around cars, you know, the wrong industry. And what almost every macroeconomic assessment has shown is that on net, there was a net increase in jobs in the United States, even associated with NAFTA, which was a very unique experiment in that it brought in a relatively poor emerging market country into a free trade agreement with a very large, sophisticated, industrialized country. You know, in fact, both Canada and the U.S. were very similar, and Mexico was very different. But I think clearly out of this equation, Mexico benefited far and away the most. But the, all of the studies that I've seen would say that all fair countries benefited dramatically in the end. As I said, you know, I think about our exports, you know, to Mexico, it's a dramatic improvement. And the Caterpillars exported many fold what we used to export to Mexico. The finished product. We do a lot of work in Mexico, bring it here, we do a lot of work here that goes to Mexico. So it's hard to vet those things out. And the Pacific Agreement, you know, the Peterson Institute, I think, the most sophisticated analysis of the benefits of trade would estimate that the average American family from trade liberalization, which has occurred over time, probably not since the Kennedy Amendment, this was several years ago, was over $12,000 per family. People don't think about the fact that all of a sudden you have many more goods to choose from, and the price competition is lower the price dramatically so you can buy a lot more with your purchasing power. And that creates real wealth. And that's, you know, nobody thinks about that part of trade. But walk around the store one day and think about all the things you might not be able to have at low prices if you couldn't buy anything that is important. And we're still doing pretty well. Yes.
Thanks again for coming to speak with us today. And I was just wondering your figure that showed unemployment, how you had another line above it that showed the expanding unemployment rate, and how you mentioned that that comes from people who are underemployed or maybe employed by
part-time jobs, working at a job that their skill set.
Yes, sir. And with that, just being a college student moving toward graduation, is that something that the federal government needs to address as they do regular unemployment, or is that something that's more just runs the course, or is that something that they do aim to address?
I think it kind of runs its course as part of the friction in the economy, and it's probably a lot better in our economy here than it would be, say, in the European economy, where a lot more social programs that say you don't have to work in order to have income. And here people run out of ways and they're forced to find jobs, maybe their jobs that aren't optimal. But I think more of that number reflects people that are working in part-time jobs or seasonal jobs that aren't permanent. And so that number is coming down as fast or faster than the official unemployment number. The interesting thing in our economy, I think there's a very legitimate concern about income distribution issues. We just have to be sure we don't fix the wrong thing in trying to address the problem. Because a combination of productivity growth and globalization have, I think, dramatically increased the income distribution problem. I mean, if you have a great idea these days, and if you globalize that idea, you can be worth a lot of money. Just if you develop a software app that can be sold the world over, you don't just become millionaire, you can make a billionaire pretty quickly. Pretty distorted. If you think about a company like Caterpillar and all we've invested in technology over the years, we're probably producing, say the same amount of tractors would take 20% of the number of people in the quote hourly workforce that it used to take. And a lot of that is the job requirements have shifted dramatically. Now you need a lot more people, you know, who are developing software capabilities to run robotic production lines. And interestingly enough, I think this technology now is swinging more to begin to benefit the United States. If we do the right things to invest in capital technologies, because you can't produce one of our products or a modern automobile without using the latest technology. So we're using the same robotic technologies now in Mexico and China as we use in the United States. Because otherwise you couldn't hold the tolerances. So you don't have that labor arbitrage. I think you see there's some movement of manufacturing activity back to the United States. And it's just productivity growth has been pretty dramatic with IT technology, and it's just been happening slowly over time. and sometimes they don't even realize it. Yeah, I gave the example smaller, but I was just looking at IBM's proxy statement the other day, just about issued, and I was thinking about, I've been on this board 7 years. And 7 years ago, I mean, it was a whole different vocabulary. We didn't have a cloud business. You know, now it's a $4-5 billion business growing at 40% per annum. I mean, they didn't talk about, you know, Watson and the analytics business. I mean, these things now collectively for them will be a $40 billion business by 2018 that didn't exist in 2006. It's every change in that space. And it's affecting almost everything we do. Yes, sir.
What is eating this out on here all the time?
Oh, that's probably a question that's way beyond my category. I think, well, one, American companies are pretty competitive in the world this year. Their balance sheets are pretty strong. I think they're positioning themselves in many cases to compete in world markets. Productivity growth has been good. And interest rates, perhaps you started with this, are ridiculously low levels, so relatively efficient money. A lot of companies are paying 3-3.5% dividend yields, which are tax advantage over interest. And if you buy 10-year bond, you're going to get a lot less than that. And have the risk that when interest rates go up, the bond value is going to go down. So it's part of the alternative.
Just a couple of, so Ron should have a question, but I have a lot of confusion. But so you're talking through the whole presentation. Clearly, there's a lot of dynamics and feedback globally, you know, across different factors, right? But I also kind of go back to a couple of things that's interesting for me. Growing up in India, our biggest problem in India was population factor. He said that's the worst thing that's happening to us. All of a sudden, we become our biggest asset. And as you were talking about money being left outside the US, just with the value of the dollar going up, all of the money got devalued, right? You know, right, versus paying taxes. They left it out there, the value, you know, versus the dollar. Right? They didn't pay the taxes, but the value was, you know, if they had it in euros or whatever, the dollar goes up there for the US companies and devalued. So there's a lot of little
things. We may not have had it in euros.
Oh, yeah.
The Swiss banks are keeping in US dollars.
That's true. Yeah. But I guess where the question I'm asking is really the confusion I'm trying to understand is it seems to me like everything you said suggested that over the last 30 to 50 years, whatever period you picked, economic innovation has been fighting political stagnation. Pretty much. Right. If you look at it, no political moves have really been done unless some economic innovation happened in the market. Like the foreign exchange, you know, changing the way the foreign exchange is fixed versus floating. So I guess my question to you is very simply, there are a lot of undiscovered ideas in, you know, dynamics in the market. Right, as we try new experiments, we find new things.
Correct.
So I guess the question is are we really making a mistake trying to expect politicians to solve our problems? Or should we be really trying economic innovations to drive politicians to follow the trend? I mean, as you look at that, this for the 70s.
I'm not sure I know where the question is yet, but sure there's one in there. You know, I would say one of the most exciting things that I've witnessed in my work economic career is the triumph of the human spirit in China. I mean, when I first went there in the early 80s, people were literally afraid to talk to family members almost. The Red Guard Revolution swept the country, terrible things had happened. The government was so overwhelmingly pervasive that people were shining. And, you know, Mao finally dies. New political leadership comes to the fore. They declare that being rich is okay. and we're going to begin to unleash. And I don't think it was the genius of the Communist Party that did anything. It was the genius of the Chinese people and their passion for education and learning. And all of a sudden, they, you know, people thought they didn't have family values. Well, we found out that they had deep family values. And, you know, they were dynamite when unleashed. And so having political constraints be taken off and people being allowed to flourish were hugely exciting and probably created the greatest economic renaissance miracle in the world. So I'm very optimistic about people's ability. I think, I'm not a Tea Party guy, but I think we don't need government. I think we do need rules and regulations, and we need a lot of clarity and establishing those rules. But it is frustrating sometimes that we let myths like trade is bad or the NAFTA is bad not let us move forward with trade agreements that will, I think, allow people to be freer and make better decisions and grow. And that's why I sort of my feeling is we the citizens have asked for all the deductions that are in the tax code largely. And we have a small vested interest group that fight to the end on every single one of those. And we end up with a tax code that's so complex that the American public kind of begins to lose confidence in it. So I think we need some political maturity and sanity to kind of untangle the web, simplify, as Reagan did in 1980, the tax code. Think about balancing the budget, too, of course, and think about the things the government really needs to do that only the government can do, and be sure we can pay for those things. But then simplify the tax code so that we can unleash human spirit and human capital to get it done, and let the Adam Smith's wonderful invisible hand work in the markets and the economy drive things. I mean, I think that's the right recipe. And it's a very optimistic and it's a very people-centric recipe as opposed to a centralized rule inside 4 years. You know, I'm kind of excited about New York. Are you?
But I think that's exactly what the question was. It feels like more catalyzing, unleashing people, you're saying, will drive the economy back again. And if we can get the politics out of the way to some degree, I think that's kind of.
Well, as you know, in India, there's sort of state politics that almost overwhelm national politics and a huge distrust that emerged in. It was becoming stifled. And Indian growth went from one of the highest in the BRICS to one of the lowest. And now, with new political leadership, it seems to have kicked into the higher gear very quickly, maybe faster than most people thought possible. So I think that's a pretty good case in point.
Well, I think we have it up, unfortunately. Is there any closing thought?
Thank you all for giving up a Thursday night and driving to the vehicle. I'm always proud to be here because I love a lot of things that my wife did. And crosses me people with a lot of them when I come out here and talk about economics. Economics is kind of one of my first loves academically. And it is kind of fascinating in how economics plays with global politics, not just national, but global politics, and how good economic policy can have such a profoundly positive impact on people's life. So it makes it worth supporting. So let's go forth and help our politicians get to the right decision.
Dr. Owens, thank you so much for your outstanding presentation. President J. David Arnold, come forward. We have a couple little thank you gifts for you.
Already
covered.
Oh, good. So since he increased
revenues by 40%. We have a lifetime supply.
You mentioned reading about revenue. We have another revenue book for you. I'll read it next time I come to make a talk. Where is it being?
We're a pride.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. First of all, this is such an extraordinary institution, Eureka College, celebrating our 160th anniversary this year, founded by abolitionists pre-Civil War. One of our first speakers on this campus in the first year was Abraham Lincoln, then a former congressman. And our most recent speaker, Dr. Jim Owens. In this very building, which turned 100 years old this year, Ronald Reagan captained the swim team. This was the gym, and this was the swimming pool. You can hear the splashes and diving in. That former lifeguard from Dixon, who saved 77 lives on the Rock River. And in this building, we housed prisoners of war, German prisoners of war, in World War II. In this building now, some of the most fantastic dramatic productions that you'll ever see, with student actors, student-led crews, and community members interacting, take place, and you're invited to come back for even more drama. And Holly Roke, Professor Holly Roke is with us tonight, and Professor Marty Lynch, our Chief Theater Professor, we want to thank you for hosting us in this century-old building tonight. I think Dr. Owens has elevated the experiences in this building now. The Ronald W. Reagan Society. Yes, indeed. Thank you. Ronald W. Reagan Society will keep going. Reagan Forward, we call it, with your support. And for those of you, many of you, who are members of the Ronald W. Reagan Society, including Jim Katie Owens, whose support we appreciate so greatly. And as he alluded tonight, his speaker fee was right on target. And we can't thank you enough for bringing together such a tremendous group of people to interact with us. On behalf of all of us, President J. David Arnold and Vice President for Institutional Advancement, Mike Berton, our Provost Dan Blankenship, all the faculty and all the students and all of the members of the Ronald W. Reagan Society, God bless. And thank you for being here.